if you will, turn with me to the book of Ephesians, the second chapter, verses 1 through 10. Ephesians chapter 2, verses 1 through 10. And as is custom in this branch of Zion, if you are able to rise to your feet, stand at the reading of God's holy word, we ask that you would do so just now. Ephesians chapter 2. From the Good News Translation, the Word of God reads as such. In the past, you were spiritually dead because of your disobedience and sins. At the time, you followed the world's evil way. You obeyed the ruler of the spiritual powers in space, the spirit who now controls the people who disobey God. Actually, all of us were like them and lived according to our natural desires, doing whatever suited the wishes of our own bodies and minds. In our natural condition, we, like everyone else, were destined to suffer God's anger. But God's mercy is so abundant, and His love for us is so great, that while we were spiritually dead in our disobedience, He brought us to life with Christ. It is by God's grace that you have been saved. In our union with Christ Jesus, He raised us up with Him to rule with Him in the heavenly world. He did this to demonstrate for all time to come the extraordinary greatness of His grace in the love He showed us in Christ Jesus. For it is by grace, God's grace, that you have been saved through faith. It is not the result of your own efforts, but God's gift. I said God's gift, so that no one can boast about it. God has made us what we are. And in our union with Christ Jesus, He has created us for a life of good deeds, which He has already prepared for us to do. You may be seated at the reading of God's holy word. I want to take a little twist and turn on this particular text. I want to talk with you on the subject, this is why you have been resuscitated. This is why you've been resuscitated. Let us bow, let us pray. Gracious and eternal God, we say thank you. God, we give you the praise, the glory, and all of the honor. God, you alone, all by yourself, are worthy. You are able. And so, God, as we come to this moment, God, in this worship service, God, you have been here. You have blessed us. You have touched us. Now, God, through this word, I pray, Lord, that your people might be transformed and touched. God, I pray, Lord, that the words that fall from your servant's mouth might fall on ground that is fertile and take deep root in the hearts of men, women, boys, and girls, and then sprout up at the appropriate time to be the beautiful flower that you so desire. God, you bless us right now. In Jesus' name, amen. God has made us what we are. And in our union with Christ Jesus, He has created us for a life of good deeds, which He has already prepared for us to do. This is why you have been resuscitated. As Paul sits in a prison from Rome, he pens this letter to the church of Ephesus. Paul was imprisoned because he had been preaching the good news of Jesus Christ. Paul's mission was to help this church in Ephesus embrace the vision of unity in the church. For there were divisions amongst the Gentiles and the Jews. Paul's preaching is particular to that of the Gentile nation. You remember the story of Paul, apprehended on the road to Damascus to persecute the Christians for their belief and their faith in this risen Savior called Jesus Christ. Jesus apprehends him, strikes him down, blinds him, takes him to a street called Straight, gets him together, and lets him know that you have been called, I have called you to go and preach to the Gentile nation. A Jew preaching to the Gentiles. The Gentile nation had a similar plight as we as African Americans do here in the United States of America. Paul opens the letter by praising them for their faith and encouraging them to continue on in that faith. Paul then prays prior to this section of text that is our focus today and goes back in time to help them to remember who they were and used to be as a people. Sometimes you need to see where you've been in order to be clear about where you're going in your future. Sometimes we need to be reminded of the blessings that God has given to us in moments of trial and tribulation. Paul helps them to see where they used to be, but lets them know that now where they are, you need to unify yourselves and become the people that God has called you to be. Sometimes you need to go back and see where you've been in order to be clear about where you're headed in your future. I wish that you would go with me into this text to see the following suggestions: the predicament, the plan, the power, and the promise. Now at that time, prior to their conversion, the Gentiles were faced with impending judgment and certain death. Now, this death was not necessarily a physical one, but one that alienated this particular group from experiencing life to its fullest. This predicament prevented them from living up to their true potential. Anybody in here been through some predicaments in life that caused you and prevented you from becoming who you knew God had you to be? This predicament prevented them from living up to their true potential. The predicament that Paul refers to are the sins and disobedience or transgressions of his readers, which is the church of Ephesus. But allow me to take a look, and here's where it twists. Allow me to take a look behind the curtain to expose not only the personal stuff of the Gentiles, but the stuff of others as well. The Gentiles, they had their own stuff. But I want to look at the stuff that caused them to sin and be disobedient. Yes, Paul is talking to the Gentiles and their individual situation, but I believe that he is talking about the establishment as well. More than likely, this was a letter not just to the Ephesians, but a circulated letter to all the other churches in the region. See, the predicament of sin goes both ways and prevents folks from living their best lives. On one hand, you have the predicament of personal sin and transgressions, but on the other hand, you have the predicament of the establishment's sins that too impedes the optimal living of those who tend to want to live as God would want them to live. So you have the personal sin, and then you have the sin of others who impede the sin or impedes the life in which God wants them to live. That is why you have movements like Black Lives Matter and other movements that speak to the racial injustices that are going on in our world today, that directly speak to the establishment. The Gentiles, couldn't even enjoy the gift of God because the Jewish establishment hindered their progress. Come on now, it is the empire in this case that keeps us from moving into the gift of God. The empire holds up its dusty arms, turns up their noses, and pushes their worn out rules and regulations which become impossible to follow. See, the Jewish establishment did not believe that the uncircumcised Gentile nation was worthy of the gift of Christ, and so they needed a push from Paul to help them move towards a more unified understanding of the movement that Christ had them in. It was the same way during the Jim Crow era. The rules were different for black folks. And really, I don't need to go back 75 years to let you know what happened. I can show you what's happened in the last few months right here in our country. Black folks, like Gentiles, were and are up against an oppressive system. The rules and the laws are different for us than them. In his latest book, America's Original Sin, Jim Wallace, the editor-in-chief of Sojourners Magazine, states that America is in desperate need to have a real conversation about race. This is a white man writing this. White privilege needs to be dismantled if we are to move forward in our journey. He states, and I quote, if white Christians acted more Christian than white, black parents would have less to fear for their children. Come on now. Establishment, and you look at the empire, and you look at where we are. If white Christians acted more Christian than white, black parents would have less to fear for their own black sons and daughters. Look, being a disciple requires heavy lifting if our communities are to come up and out of the predicaments that we face. We need to have a real conversation. We need to sit down at the table. We need to invite everybody to come together. It's not just personal sin, but it's public sin too. It's not just police brutality, it's racial inequity too. I may be just as qualified, but not get the same treatment when it's time for promotion. It's not just police brutality or racial inequity, but it's the personal perspective on humanity. How do you see your brother and your sister? Are you willing, just because it's outside of your community, are you willing to come together and say, I too am part of the problem, and I want to come to the table and make sure things get right? It's Black History Month, isn't it? Amen. Let me explain here. There is no way in the world that you will have a group of black men treated the same way as a group of white men when they position themselves to take over and occupy a federal government building. It's not the same. There's a double standard. If we were to go in and take over a federal building, all hell would break loose. They'd get shot. They'd have body bags. Ain't nobody talking about nothing. We're coming in, guns locked and loaded. It's not the same. Not the same. There's a double standard. Gentile Christians were not treated with the same respect as Jewish Christians. It becomes interesting when we live under the same roof, yet our differences separate us, which then thrust us into the predicaments of life. And this may sound strange to some and odd to others, but very real in a sense, and saying that we've all been in a place where the enemy has suffocated us, but it is the love, I say, it is the love of God that lifts us to a place where we can breathe fresh air and we can become who God called us to be. God's love and His mercy resuscitates us and gets us to where we need to go. I don't need to fight you with my fists. I want to fight you on my knees. And I'm going to say, God, you bless this situation, because no longer can we go forth in this way and be all right. When you've been lifted, when you've been lifted, you've been resuscitated and rescued from a barren place. That's what Paul is trying to tell to the Gentiles. You can breathe. You can breathe again. The predicaments in our lives require a particular prescription that can only be concocted by the Creator. Oh, you need to go to God in order to get your move, in order to get their next assignment, and get to what you, where to you, where you need to go, and what you need to do.
Yes.
Predicaments are a pain.
Yes.
They are.
Yes.
But a particular prescription, if you are willing and desiring to get it right, a particular prescription is necessary to alleviate the abnormalities of life. Racism is a pain. Sexism is a pain. Dirty water in Flint, Michigan is a pain. Merges God's love and His mercy, which when brought together moves us from our predicament to God's plan. Oh, a true sense of living moves us from the reality of death into an opportunity for new life. Let's not get it twisted. God is not mocked when these people do their dirty work behind the scenes. The response of God is one that is timely, it is sure, and it is full of power. God's plan is just a precursor of what glorious things are to come. God's plan through Jesus Christ moves us into a moment of power and prolepsis. In other words, the proleptic moment is that the kingdom of God manifested through Christ Jesus to us, offers to us a heaven both now and thereafter. A here, but not yet. I said a here, but not yet. Your heaven is here in Christ, but it's not yet appeared. What you shall be. Look, you don't have to wait to get to heaven to get your shout on. But not quite yet, but it's coming. Jones, where a unique blend of African American Christian along with African religious traditional values emerged to form what is what we know today to be the Black Church. Here in this particular institution, in this hush arbor, you will find the secret worship services of those of our African ancestors. See, out of the creative musings of slave religion came the unique and rhythmic melodies that spoke a language of freedom. Oh, these creative moments of song and worship were the plans and pathways to our freedom land. See, the songs we created held important messages within them about the plan to escape to freedom. That developed in the midnight hour of the Black worship experience helped convey the thought that even though I may find myself in a barren condition created by sinful folks, that's folks doing stuff to me, putting me in a place, I will not succumb to their narrow values that they hold for me. I'm going to shout. Necessarily want to talk about, and these are the things that continue to keep us where we are. Don't be talking about white privilege, don't be talking about white supremacy, don't be talking about racism. Well, I'm going to talk about it, and I'm going to continue to go there. It's Black History Month, and even when God's Fair March, March 8th of May, I'm going to talk about the same thing.
That's right.
We need to talk about it, preach about it, teach about it, to help our people see some of the same things that we do today are a direct result of our slave condition that we were in. And that's not just Price Davis's assessment. That's in a book. You can go and read about that. People perspectives, lift up all of these things to help us to see what the conditions were really like. The spirituals help to resuscitate an oppressed people and provide hope in the darkest hour of that long night of slavery. The spirituals provided the plan and the power. Paul was helping the Gentile nation see that through God's love and mercy, there was an alternative to the empire. You need to be kingdom living and not empirical living. You need to live in God's kingdom, displaying God's character, walking in the way in which God called you to walk, and not walking the way that the world wants you to walk. There was an alternative to the struggle I find fighting within myself and outside of myself. See, the sins I commit and the sins others commit that directly impact the quality of another's life are very evident. Paul, or the disciple in which Paul was writing, or the people that Paul was writing to, he was trying to help them shift their mindset. See, one of the things we must understand is that the power does not come from outside them. The power comes from within. The power of an all-loving God who is able to bring Gentile and Jewish communities together. Because when you continue to read on in the 11th verse, that is the beginning of when Paul begins to show the Jewish and the Gentile the communities how they will begin to live and how they ought to come together and make amends and recognize that they serve one God. And once you have moved from predicament to plan to experience the real power in your life, you are then called to fulfill the promise of what he put in you. And here it is. Here is why you've been resuscitated. See, verse 10 says, "For you are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do." See, the reason why you have been resuscitated is so that you can be of benefit to the community in which you have been called. It's not enough to just sit on your salvation. Now that you have known who you are, now that you know who you are and to whom you belong, you will say, like Ella Baker said, you gotta get up and do something. You gotta get up and move. Now that you're free, now that you understand the plan and power for your life that God has for you, you are called to go and help others be free. You are a disciple of Christ. That is what God is talking about here. That is what Paul is speaking of. He is talking about disciples moving in places where they can go outside of the church walls and spread the love of Christ. See, you are a disciple formed in the image of Christ. And because you are that, he calls you to go. Not do bad works. He says do good works.
That's right.
Here's the Price Davis definition of discipleship. A disciple of God is a person called by God, positioned to listen, to love, to learn, and to lean on the teacher in order that they may go out to train, to teach, to translate, and to team up with other folks. You are a disciple. This is the huddle. Monday through Saturday is you carrying out the play. There is one call, but many functions. Don't doubt for one moment that you may need to be placed or sent somewhere else, because it gets a little rough and it gets a little rocky along the way. Oh, look, you are here. You are where you are supposed to be, because God has planted you right here. You are a disciple. The text says that he has already prepared that which you are to do before you even became a disciple. When you were in your mother's womb, oh, God already had in plan in store for what you are to do right here and right now. You can look at me funny if you want to. No one else can do what God has set in motion a long time ago. He prepared it because he knew only you could do it. So go ahead, get involved, do something, be radical for Christ. Step out and dream the dreams and visions that God has given to you. Step out and combat the ills within your community. Get out and vote. Get out and register. Get out and help somebody else vote. Deacon the Squire already said it. You sitting back talking about all of this political stuff, but you won't get up out your house and go vote on the day in which you're supposed to vote. If you don't go vote, stay in your house and don't say nothing. The injustices happening in your community. Don't just post it on Facebook. You need to write a to-do on your calendar book and go do what you just posted on Facebook. Go walk your communities. Go tell your people. Let everybody know that God is alive in you. You are no longer dead to Christ, but because of his love and his mercy, he gave you the power to go above and beyond and to do what he called you to do. It doesn't take a whole lot. This may not be the sermon that you were looking for. It doesn't take a whole lot. God knew that you would be here right now. All right. And those issues and concerns happening in your world right now, these are the events that God has carefully crafted and created for you to handle. All right.
All right.
It's too big. We can't do that. We can't go there. That's too much. Is that what God said?
No.
Is that what God said?
No.
It's not that it's too hard or that there are not enough resources. But the question is, are you willing to walk in your car?
All right. All right.
I encourage you. I implore you to be the disciples that God has called you to be.
All right.
That you might recognize that there is a love greater than anything that you can ever imagine.
Oh, yes.
That there are things that you have been specifically called to do. Be quiet for a moment. Listen to God. Follow his footpath.
Yes, yes.
And he will guide you and direct you.
Yes, yes.
In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name.